Hello and welcome to another episode of India Risk Report. And in this episode, we are focusing on corporate compliance and governance issues, particularly in the light of the fact that India's industry and corporate houses have been in the news on and off because of certain cases where there have been reports of accounting frauds, deliberate defaults, and also unethical business practices. But few and far between, but there are concerns that have been raised, particularly in the light of the fact that some very big corporate houses and institutions have come under the scanner. And to look at the challenges that the Indian industry faces and the government of India faces, and therefore what is really of concern to foreign investors in India, we have an exceptional guest with us. We have Dr. Harish Krishnaswamy, who is the CEO of Tata Trust. Dr. Krishnaswamy, welcome on the show, and I'm going to call you Harish hereafter because I know you're comfortable with that. We also have with us on the show Ms. Sagarika Chakraborty, who is the CEO of IIRIS Consulting, and Sagarika has considerable understanding of issues related with corporate governance. So my first question to you is, this is regarding the ongoing current scenario relating to corporate governance environment in India. And, you know, there are several incidents of fraud and misappropriation. That's what the first thing that comes to everybody's mind. And unfortunately, I still believe they are few and far between, but they have sullied the image of a lot of corporate large entities and raised questions that is their compliance really happening, or at the end of the day, the board of directors is saying one thing and doing another thing?
I think there is a, in the past two decades, we've been seeing a lot of mistaken notion that what the stakeholder wants or what the shareholder wants is ultimately profits. And that is a very mistaken notion. For me, the shareholder is a very hypothetical person, and the notional goal of his is profit maximization is extremely wrong. But on the other side, we have seen in the, especially in the last 2-3 years, there has been a lot of things which have happened in the industry also. For example, in the mutual funds and the pension funds, the resolutions have to be vetted by the shareholders, and this has been told by the respective regulators in 2012 and 2016. The IRDA has come out with a stewardship code for institutional investors. The 2013 Companies Act has very clearly defined the roles of independent directors, associate directors, nominee directors. So there has been a lot of action which has also happened on the scene.
Well, I'd just like to come in here because there are two issues that you've raised, and I think we need to take that forward. One is, how important is the role of the shareholder in terms of deciding future course of action of the companies? Because the evidence that seems to be coming out again and again is that the board of directors are often able to push the line they think which is convenient. And even if compliance is to be implemented, then the burden comes on to the shareholder. So there is that one aspect. And though he is not or she is not consulted on a regular basis, and they're told this is the best deal that you are probably getting. And then the issue of independent directors. You know, independent directors, you talked about, you know, when post the Satyam scandal, the government went fairly strongly in favor of having good independent directors. But there is no such measure, by and large, that is adopted in India of doing headhunting for independent directors, seeking out talent, and then often the independent directors are known to be connected to the family or the promoters that are holding the company. And promoters are a very uniquely Indian word. So therefore, they get appointed, and but after their appointment, they do not really play a very effective role. And if they do raise their voice, then they are sidelined or removed. Now, all this is correct, or am I completely off the mark?
I think you've raised a very, very important, the DNA of the entire corporate governance spirit. Shareholders, the right and equitable treatment of stakeholders, not only shareholders, but other stakeholders, is, I think, a very, very pivotal factor in the corporate governance framework. For example, if you take in the world over, for example, let us take Australia. In Australia, every shareholder can remove the director at any given point of time. You just need 100 shareholders or 5% of the shareholders to actually call for a board meeting in Australia. Mm-hmm. So those kinds of high and stringent standards are set in other countries. In India, I think the government, the SEBI, has taken the committee, you know, the Kotak committee's recommendations and have laid a lot of stress on two aspects of what you spoke about. One is on the independence directors and second on the role of the shareholders out there. Now, from a shareholder's perspective, I think the first thing what we have taken care of, which probably is in the phase one, has been disclosure and transparency. So you have a lot of information which has been available to shareholders, which was earlier not there, in terms of financial reporting, in terms of your analysis and all those. The second is the right and equitable treatment of shareholders. For example, do you have a mandate? So earlier from four meetings, you are having five meetings, you are having a web, you have the quality of the board meeting, which is the quality of the AGM and all those, which is the second phase which has happened. The third phase is the responsibilities of the board towards shareholders. So there you come across the independent. So the role has been defined, the powers of the board has been defined, which has taken place. The fourth important aspect, which has not, in my opinion, still happened in India, is basically all the consultation of the stakeholders has not taken place, which for me, you can have a definition of a related party transaction, but how does it apply there and what are the conduits to it in a corporate setting? Those, so that forms the spirit of the corporate India. And I am seeing with the kinds of frauds, the kinds of things, for example, you know, the Fortis episode, you know, the episodes which are all happening across India, I think is all pointing towards a fair amount of degree of power to the shareholders. And I think that sensibility will prevail. And I think even, you know, the SEBI has also given the assigned the criminal culpability. So all this is strengthening the system. I think we are getting there, but it's going to take us some more time to reach the kind of standards which we want in a country like this.
You know, somebody once made a very profound remark, and the person said that, you see, when you expect a corporation to have conscience, you forget the fact that it has no soul or no body to be kicked or soul to be damned. So what I'm alluding to is that, are we expecting too much out of corporations purely because a few scandals have rocked the imagination of people and making it very difficult for corporations to move forward? Or because of these new measures, promoters, family members and others will stop working on a philosophy of a wink and a smile and letting everything go through? How do you draw the balance?
For me, I think corporate governance is not corporate governance, but it should start with individual governance. If you look at India, unfortunately, I think like in the other parts of the world, we are also following the westernized culture, which is a model good enough for them. But if you really look at rudiments, we are probably talking from a complete westernized as what has happened there in the fraud. They immediately got about a governance, a transparency, a voluntary, a mandatory kind of an approach, which we are trying to adopt. Even right now, what we are adopting is basically the Anglo-Saxon model, which is followed by UK. You know, that is the kind of model which we adopt. But inherently, I feel the Indian culture rests on something called the Swadharma, Swa. You know, you have a Swachh Bharat, you have everything, which is Swa. Swa means what? Starts with the individual. Ultimately, three things are very important, whether it be the board, whether it be a middle management, or every person in that organization, until you have a value system in it. So it starts with not only commitment, it not only starts with competency and skills, but I think the fundamental thing of everything in decision making, I think, goes to that character. If a person, an individual, so if the leader has got a character, he knows what he wants particularly from that organization.
So Sagarika, what is your view on the cost that this involves in terms of corporate governance? How does it, you know, pan out in the case of companies which do not follow good governance, come into the spotlight And then it kind of sullies the image of many others who are probably trying to do the right thing.
So Maroof, with regard to the question, I think I will break it up into two parts. That the first being what the companies think that the cost is. Now, the company's perception mainly is that the cost is a unilateral thing with a 180 degree view, that it can either be the regulatory cost, that is the compliance issues or certain fines, and it can also be how the public is perceiving and the impact on the share market. However, on the much more larger plane, it is actually a 360 degree perspective that we are missing out on. The cost and the risk implications also include that what is the employees thinking about it? What are the employees thinking about it? What is the attrition rate? What about the ease of doing business parameters when you have a foreign investor on board? Are they really looking to partner with you? Lack of good governance actually percolates down all these issues. And that is why the companies need to understand that it is not a department issue. It is a senior management issue because the impact and the risk affects the companies at large and in perspectives that we cannot even think about.
Well, I think very comprehensively brought out by you, but quite clearly compliance issues and good governance, there are many dimensions to it. There is the legal dimension, there is the corporate dimension, and most importantly is the ethical dimension. And we have looked at some of those, but we'll be back after a break to look at what all can be done in terms of good practices and what are the best models to follow, and most importantly, how the independent director can be made more effective. But that after a break. Welcome back. We are continuing with the India Risk Report episode on good governance and compliance issues, particularly with respect to many of the corporate companies. And we continue to have our two experts with us. We have with us Dr. Harish of the Tata Trust, and we have Sagarika Chakraborty, who is the CEO of IIRIS Consulting. Dr. Harish, do you really feel that the issues of transparency and the issues related with the whistleblower policy, which is again a very big aspect, because what has happened is that under the existing legislation, a complaint cannot be filed anonymously. A person needs to be identified as to who has filed the complaint, and then only it will be taken seriously. Isn't this a shortcoming?
I think it is a shortcoming, and also to extend it further, it also says as to two things have come about as to why this law was framed in such a manner that the whistleblower ultimately cannot be anonymous. One is to make sure that either the vigilant or any other regulator is able to give him protection, which is a good cause. And the second is also, it can just be that you keep whistle, I mean, all that you have is just a whistle and you can keep blowing, right? So also to make sure that it is always not a false alarm, because any false alarm can have serious repercussions.
So therefore the need for the person's name to be identified and put his name, stick his neck out.
Correct.
That listen, I'm making this claim, now check it out.
Correct. And the third thing, which again is another shortcoming, is that this is only pertaining in case of a financial crime. So if there are any other operational issues, I don't think it deserves that kind of an approach. Mm-hmm. So I think that also is a lacuna in the system right now. Mm-hmm. There. Mm-hmm. But I think the tenets behind as to why we had this whistleblowing policy is probably these three as to why they wanted to have it that way.
Okay, the other thing is the, not the corruption per se, but the impression internationally that there is a high degree of corruption in many countries, including India. And this has resulted in many investors choosing, for example, Singapore as a venue for arbitration, or even standing back and observing to what extent are we ethically sorted out and cleaned up before they put their money into investments here. And even under the Companies Act of 1956, only 3,000 rupees or so could be the penalty put on somebody who is allegedly corrupt. And that's a very small penalty considering the kind of crores that are often siphoned off. So what's your take on that?
Corruption happens at different degrees in a corporate setup. One is in terms of even an insider trading is a form of a fraud and a form of a corruption. In terms of supplier, a vendor management, there is a different kind of a fraud. There is a different kind of a fraud in terms where a promoter, which we were talking about, or a board, a person given the decision-making authority takes the wrong thing and then probably siphons funds, where we have seen in these two, three cases where they have siphoned funds. Now, when we have to attack corruption, I think we'll have to move from a point of view of not only imposing voluntary checks or mandatory checks, but also having strict regulations. Today, the regulations are not stringent enough to basically tackle this at a corporate level. And I think we need to beef up our regulation, our legislation systems to tackle this, this disease.
You know, studies have also shown that private equity funded initiatives and companies display higher standards of corporate governance as compared to many others. And the difference primarily arises from the application of advanced country standards of corporate governance or best practices which are available elsewhere. I mean, your company, Tata's, has a very, very big reputation in a way as a role model for many other companies. Do you buy this line?
Sir, this probably could be true for startups. Especially when a startup is coming forward, I think when there is a stipulation by a promoter or by an angel investor saying that I need certain standards of corporate governance. Because what happens in the case of a startup, I think the most important facet for a startup or an, you know, a person who has that passion is basically resources, right? Because it's lack of resources and he's only trying to mobilize resources, whether it be human resources, whether it be financial resources. At that point of time, the focus on corporate governance or the importance of corporate governance wouldn't be instilled in that person. And I think, you know, when an angel investor or a private equity investor is brought into the board to give him that resources, it comes with a tag. So he says, I expect some degree of corporate governance in the structure. I expect some, you know, I expect some degree of independence. I expect some reporting. I expect some code of conduct, some, you know, all those. So I think that automatically, I think it's a fantastic bulletproof when the startup actually goes on to the next stage. And I, in my opinion, I think if even the Tatas are today what they are as Tatas, it is because of the strong code of conduct which they have built. Today, as we celebrate 150 years of the Tata Group, I think it is the vision of the founder and the strong code of conduct which has helped this establishment stay this tenure in the space.
Well, we could say that for a number of other good companies in the country also. But, you know, I mean, with your vast connections worldwide, and Tata's has branches in many major countries, do you suggest any good practices that could come as a proposal promoted by the Tata Group to the government and to other companies, that these good practices should also become the norm in India?
Any strict policy or any policy which is not even mandated by a legislation is taken care of. For example, let us say in a stakeholder consultation, a business continuity consultation is done with an employee engagement, with a supplier engagement. I think we have gone to that level, next level of corporate governance, which is not a mandated, but which is something voluntarily. So when the corporates take up such voluntary measures and increase their own degree of corporate governance within their corporate setup, I think India as a whole, automatically we will do it. There was a very interesting, you know, a research report, I think by the World Bank Group, I think IFC, I think it was also supported by the Singapore, the Japanese government, which got published in January 18, where they did a study of about, you know, all the 100, BSC companies. And it was a very nice report because there were four or five facets where they looked about, and almost 80 to 90% of these companies were actually having almost at least above fair standards of corporate governance, which means over and above the minimum requirement which is mandated. And I think that is the next step. How voluntarily corporate appreciate the governance and take it upon themselves as their responsibility. So it is just like a corporate social responsibility. Corporate governance should also be a responsibility of each of these corporates.
Yeah, my last question to you is, you know, about 15 years ago, the government had initiated this whole idea of independent directors. This was to be done through due diligence. Many companies abroad, at least, use headhunters and do a very thorough check of independent directors. Here, more often than not, either people are picked up with connections to the owners or the directors of the company, or people who are well known in public life. And again, they are not too familiar with the subject of the basic business focus of the company on which they are directors. I mean, you could, for example, be an eminent playwright or an eminent actor, and you could be put for that purposes on the corporate governance, to assess corporate governance in a company which is dealing with export of metals, for example. So how do you balance this out? How do you make this whole issue of independent directors more effective?
See, if you take, for example, a developed country like, let's say, UK, I think the independent director, I mean, from the companies where I worked in the past, the independent director is a profession. So people, what is your profession? I'm an independent director, which means it comes with a set of responsibilities. Of course, it has got rights, but it comes with a set of responsibilities. The remuneration may be high. They have close to around 6 to 7 meetings, and they also have, you know, web telecasts. They have video conferencing to that much extent they're doing. I'm not saying that the independent director has to, you know, overtake the management. The management is the management because they are meant to manage the company. Okay. But as an independent director, when you start treating it very seriously, I think, as you rightly said, today the promoter or anybody else may not like it as much because it is a convenience. But when independence becomes not a convenience, it becomes a very important tool for us to basically show it as a report card for the board themselves.
Okay, Sagarika, you've heard Dr. Harish. In your mind, what would be the most responsible way forward?
So I actually agree to almost all the pointers that Harish has brought forth, and I think he's very comprehensively covered those pointers. With regard to the solution making, it's a much more broader concept. So let me just put out ideas and not solution over there. I will connect it to my first answer, which had the part of it that the first step is to recognize that corporate governance cannot be limited to a single team. It is a collective responsibility, it is a collective effort, and it directly goes back to the senior management to set the tone. The first thing is that they need to understand that you have to be open to risk management. It cannot be just an AGM or an annual review or those kind of a board meeting issues. You have to learn to quantify these issues and how it impacts the balance sheet. The other thing is that the skill base, we need to make our juniors, we need to make the second tier more and more aware. There needs to be training sessions, effective awareness sessions, and yes, finally, we have to set the tone culturally. There has to be whistleblowing platforms, there has to be proper policy guidelines, there has to be gap analysis, and yes, once you set the tone and you set the ball rolling, you've already taken the first step. Then it is all about management. It is all about like a maintenance thing which you do for your each and every department for each other issues. So I guess the first step is to recognize and take that one little leap forward.
Right, right, right. Well, I think again, once again, very comprehensively brought out, and these are the areas that must be taken very serious note of. Thank you all for watching. And we'll be back next week with another episode. Until then, goodbye.